coming up on Need to Know Rochester. In the midst of Detroit's bankruptcy, we look at how once thriving cities like Rochester, now in need of an economic boost, can rise from the ashes. Turns out some believe surrounding suburbs could be doing a lot more to help out. Also on the show, we're talking PGA Championship. It's now in full swing in Rochester, and Tiger Woods says he's happy to be back. We'll hear from the golf champ and look at how the region is being impacted by the PGA. Plus, a former city council member joins us to share the story behind her new book. It's all coming up right now on Need to Know Rochester.
Rochester's news magazine since 1997. This is Need to Know Rochester.
Hello and thank you for joining me for this edition of Need to Know Rochester. I'm Helene B. and Duty Hofer. It's being called one of the great tragedies of American history, the fall of Detroit, Michigan. And while speculation continues about what's next for the city after its recent bankruptcy filing, a lot of cities are examining their own financial condition. Recently, a spokesperson with the New York Council of Mayors said there are a number of upstate cities that share many of the troubles that plague Detroit. And State Comptroller Tom DiNapoli has said that everything must be done to make sure no cities in our state are forced to file for bankruptcy. There's been a lot of talk about what could have been done to prevent Detroit's demise and what could still be done to help other cities that are hurting financially. One option is to look at a city surrounding suburbs for support. So would the regionalization of government and its services work between Rochester and area suburbs like Pittsford, Brighton, and Fairport? To find out, we're joined by Sandy Frankel, former Brighton Town Supervisor, and Chris Wilmot, co-owner and co-publisher of the Smugtown Beacon. Chris is also a former Monroe County legislator. Thank you both so much for joining me for this discussion.
Thank you.
And just to start off, describe the relationship between the city of Rochester and its surrounding suburbs. And does a relationship even exist, I guess?
Certainly between the town of Brighton and the city of Rochester, there's been a long-standing, close relationship. Brighton, in fact, encompassed what is the east side of the city of Rochester in its early days, until the city annexed more areas and Brighton became what it is today. But that having been said, over the past 20 years, as supervisor, I work closely with the mayor of the city of Rochester to establish some intermunicipal cooperation agreements so that we could operate certain functions more efficiently, more cost effectively. And those relationships worked well until certain economic demands within the city changed or within the town of Brighton. But there are real potential opportunities for increased cooperation, collaboration. There are many that already exist, but there's more that could be done.
So we'll get into some of those that do exist. But Chris, let me ask you, do you think that the suburbs should step up and play a role? Should they feel a responsibility in helping out the city?
Yes, I mean, by law, they don't have to. And I researched this before I came on the program, that under New York Municipal Law, Article 17, there are sections 700 through 719. But basically what that says is that by design, cities can no longer annex surrounding areas. In fact, in my reading, and I'm not an attorney, but in my reading of the law, only villages unilaterally, if the village votes that way, could maybe perhaps annex part of towns surrounding them. The problem is, unlike the South and the West, we don't have any unincorporated parts of counties in New York State. Every square inch of real estate in New York State is either a village, a town, a city, or a county. So Rochester, New York is 37 square miles. That's tiny. New York City, by contrast, is 300 square miles. Los Angeles is 460. They have a gigantic tax base. They have their struggles. But the fact is, when you look at a city like Rochester with 37 square miles, a lot of the real estate is already off the tax rolls. Universities, churches, places of worship, museums. So you have a declining tax base. You have a lower income city than we once had. And if not legally, I think morally and ethically, the suburbs have a responsibility to save Rochester and not let it become the next Youngstown, Ohio, Detroit, Michigan, Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. The capital of Pennsylvania is bankrupt. So San Bernardino, California, large suburb of Los Angeles, is bankrupt. This is happening all over the country. And we're destined to go that direction unless the suburbs start to realize that the city is the heart of this county and the community.
So what can a suburb do?
Well, the fact is that we are interdependent on one another. We cannot survive as suburbs without a strong city. And so we really do have to work together and find solutions that are politically acceptable and that will really make a positive difference. One concern clearly is the concentration of poverty in the city. The more recent economic development in downtown is a good thing. We had some projects in Brighton that were potential, and in fact they went to the city, and I think that was a good decision for the region because it helped to strengthen the real estate and business center of our community. But the fact is that we need to come together and take a new look, a fresh look at what we might be able to do. When you ask what kind of cooperative agreements exist, we can come up with a very long list, but that doesn't address some of the underlying problems. Some of the agreements.
Do you have any specifics that you can
give me?
Well,
for example, we have there's a cooperative relationship among the libraries. We share 911. We cooperate on highway maintenance, road maintenance. There are relationships in law enforcement between the sheriff and the local police departments. There are a lot of relationships that have been long-standing and they're solid, but we also need to look at what it would take to help strengthen the city. When you look at some of the challenges facing Detroit, they're not any different than we have in New York State.
Right.
There are pensions, there are health insurance costs, there are a variety of high cost components of local budgets. And I think it's important that the state also take a look at how it needs to reinforce and support our local governments. It should be a partnership, and that's really a critical aspect.
Well, Chris, something I read, you proposed an arrangement where each town and village would contribute 0.5% of their annual budgets to the city coffers, and that would add up to tens of millions of dollars. First, is there any support for such an idea? Is there a scenario where something like this could work well?
Great question. Absolutely, there's no support. And the reason I say that is because, you know, let's be honest, as human beings, as families, schools, communities, we're all a bit territorial, and that's understandable. There's nothing inherently wrong with that. But what's what is where this becomes a huge problem is that, you know, we recreate in the city. We go to the beaches. We go to the harbor. I was just up at Pier 45, the restaurant up at Charlotte. It's wonderful. I felt like I was on vacation, sailboats going in and out. We go to Salem Stadium. We go to Frontier Field. We go to museums. But you know what? We as suburbanites, I live in Pittsburgh. I assume Sandy still lives in Brighton. I'm back in my hometown where I grew up. So we use the city over and over, but as suburbanites, we don't pay our fair share. And that's not, no one decided that explicitly. It's just the way governance has developed in New York State. So my 0.5% proposal is a minimal tax, let's say an urban tax on villages, towns, maybe school districts. But it would raise 10 to 15 to 20 million if you went up to 1%, even a little bit more. The annual deficit the city is facing is around $30 million, I believe, if I'm not mistaken. So again, without calling it an urban tax, and again, there's no prerogative legally, there's no mandate that says suburbs would have to do this. But again, if we're smart and we treasure our city and the history of our city and what it means to the rest of the community, then we better do something. And last but not least, when the PGA is here right now, the Buffalo Bills come here every summer. We just had a film made here, the Spider-Man movie. No one ever says, hey, it's near Gates, New York. No one ever says it's not far from Hilton or Fairport or Henrietta or Pittsburgh. They always say Rochester, New York. That's the center of a 1.1 million person metro. It's large, but the city is clearly dying, and it's not Tom Richards' fault. It's not Lovely Warren's fault. It's the way governance is set up.
I want to go to education, and I want to look at, you know, many families in the city, they just don't have viable options outside of the city simply because of the fact of there's a lack of low-income housing in the suburbs. So how did we get to this point where there are so few options in terms of low-income housing in suburbs?
actually in the suburbs, the fair housing law, the federal law, requires that there be a distribution of housing options, that there be some affordable housing. And the zoning laws of New York State have set up a structure that have made that difficult in certain towns, especially towns that have lot sizes that are very large, a 5-acre lot, even a 1-acre lot. So the zoning laws need to adapt within each municipality to accommodate what is affordable housing. And in Brighton, one of the things that we had done, and I hope we'll continue to do, is to require a certain percentage, say 10% of new housing units in certain developments to be affordable, to meet the 80% of the median county income standard for people who will live in those houses. And we actually developed a whole new neighborhood of affordable homes. That was a collaboration of the state, not-for-profits, and town government. And it worked, well. It is now a wonderful neighborhood along with all the other neighborhoods in Brighton.
Let's talk about the urban suburban, though, because this is an example of something that's working.
Well,
why are there not more options for urban suburban programming?
Well, let me tell you that just on the housing issue, one of the things we did for that development was to have a lottery, and the first cut was for city residents, the second for Brighton residents, and the third, anyone from Monroe County.
Chris, you've got 30 seconds.
Okay, quickly, we don't have enough urban-suburban transfer in this county to get low-income kids that have aspirations in life to get out of a school system that, frankly, is failing, and it's not the school system's fault. It's the way it's set up. The other thing is, there's subtle racism and prejudice in this part of the country. You know, we always look at the South as where, you know, the KKK was dominant and the Civil War, of course. But the fact is, there's code language up here, and the suburbs control the state of New York. They control the United States, actually. And until the suburbs take some responsibility, the city cannot win. It cannot succeed.
A lot to talk about here. Chris Wilmot, co-owner and co-publisher of the Smugtown Beacon, and former Brighton Town Supervisor Sandy Frankel. Thank you both for being here with me this
afternoon.
Thank you very much. Glad to be here.
And Rochester, you know, it should be feeling a lot of love this week. The eyes of the golfing world are on our area for the 95th PGA Championship, and more than 200,000 people are visiting Monroe County for the event. It's expected to pump tens of millions of dollars into New York's economy. I stopped by Oak Hill Country Club earlier this week to check out the club's East Course, talk with some avid golfers and spectators, and to hear what one fan favorite had to say about the tournament's host town. Here's a look.
It's a great venue. The people are so into it up here.
There's definitely no shortage of golf greats in Rochester right now. If you're one of the lucky ones with a PGA ticket, the golf stars have been fairly easy to spot during practice rounds on Oak Hill's East Course and signing autographs for fans. But even though more than 150 players from around the world are here competing, there seems to be a short list for the players who the fans are most interested in.
I'm thinking Brant Snedeker is going to win it this year.
Why him?
I mean, he's due for it, and he's been playing well lately, and I think he's just a good guy.
And you know, I'm a Tiger fan.
What about you?
Tiger watcher.
Now, tell me, do you have dibs on any one person in particular to walk away?
I have three, actually.
Tell me about them.
Tiger, Phil Mickelson, and Adam Scott.
Looking forward to Tiger Woods getting his first major in a long while.
So you're banking on Tiger then?
Yes.
What makes you think that he'll walk away the winner?
Because, you know, last week at Bridgestone, I mean, he looked like he's back to his old form.
And according to Tiger Woods, he is doing well. During a press conference this week, he said he's feeling good, fresh off his Bridgestone win. But he admits the Oak Hill course is one of the toughest he's ever encountered.
I mean, you have to hit the ball well here. And if you look at the guys who have won here, they're all, you know, really good ball strikers. It just puts a premium on hitting the ball in the fairway and hitting the ball in the greens, because there are a whole lot of opportunities out there to make birdie, but there's certainly a lot of opportunities to go the other way.
And while Tiger is pretty much the talk of the town, some golf fans of a younger generation say the 20-something players on the PGA Tour, like Ricky Fowler, shouldn't be overlooked.
I like him because he's like, he kind of represents, like, the people
from, you know, like, this generation, because they all, like, they're, like, all about, like, the flashy colors and the flat brim hats. Well, I think it gets more people at a younger age interested, which gets more people to start playing.
In the midst of all the speculation on who will walk away the PGA champ on Sunday, Lieutenant Governor Bob Duffy says one winner has already been revealed, the Rochester economy. He says the tournament has about a $78 million impact on this community.
It is putting people to work. It's putting food on people's plates. It's creating jobs and excitement to see cars and people pouring down the streets. I don't believe that $78 million even takes into consideration all the families in their front yards parking cars for blocks. It's just a great thing to see kids out there hawking cars, like being at a carnival.
Today we've made about $100 so far with 5 cars, so it's not bad. But hopefully by the end of the week, hopefully around $1,000 or $2,000.
And that goal is probably not a lofty one if golf fans show up and support this event like Tiger Woods predicts they will.
This is a great golfing town. The communities come out. I wasn't part of the 95 Ryder Cup, but seeing the atmosphere and how loud and how ruckus, you know, everyone was, and experiencing it here in 03, and obviously the last 2 days, you know, so far this week, you know, people are into it. They're into their sport up here, into golf.
Even with all the excitement surrounding the PGA, some say it's the LPGA, played every year in Rochester, that provides the most entertainment for the game of golf.
Not muscle, but they hit so well, long, straight. So
you're able to see a difference then between the female and the male players.
Oh, yes. I learned more by watching female players. You know. Plus, they're more beautiful to look at.
For continuing coverage of the PGA Championship at Oak Hill Country Club, go to our website, WXXINews.org. Everyone has a story. Some stories become newspaper headlines or Hollywood films. Some may start nationwide or global movements, and others could even help influence policy changes. And then there are some stories that reveal a glimpse of history we haven't heard much about. A new book by former Rochester City Council member Maxine Childress Brown tells that kind of story. On the Beat of Truth is the name of the book, and it's about Maxine's parents and her childhood. It's a look at the Black Deaf community at the start of the 20th century. And joining us now to learn more about the story is Maxine Childress Brown herself, and thank you for being here.
Oh, it's a pleasure to be here. Thank you.
Maxine, you grew up in Washington, D.C. You later moved to Rochester in the 70s, and according to your book, the language of your youth was American Sign Language. Both your parents, Herbert and Thomasina Childress, were deaf, but neither you nor your two sisters are. So what was it about your story, your parents' story, that led you to write this memoir?
Well, frankly, in growing up in a deaf family, and as the oldest, I spoke very much and imitated my parents' sounds, so that when I entered elementary school, many of the teachers there couldn't decipher what I was saying, frankly. And so when I, my mother was a first teacher of the deaf, first Black teacher of the deaf in North Carolina. And so I knew the alphabet, I knew how to write different things, but I just couldn't pronounce them very clearly. So that, in addition to all the other nuances that take place with deaf people, period, but particularly because they're Black and because they have to, if you will, suffer the double syndrome, double yoke syndrome is what I call it. First, that they are a minority as a Black person, and then secondly, because they're deaf.
Your parents were part of the Great Migration, when millions of African Americans moved from the South to the North during the greater part of the 20th century. What was the climate for the Black deaf community at that time?
It was difficult. It was difficult to find work, and my grandfather, Clarence Brown, had to leave North Carolina, as you've already indicated, and come to Washington, and he began as a bricklayer. My father was trained as a shoe repairman, and he was able to get a trade. Because he had a trade, he was able to get work, but there were many deaf people who didn't have a trade, and many Black people obviously had a difficulty in finding work.
One thing I thought was interesting in the memoir, you said that as the African vernacular changed in urban communities, so too did sign language. And what developed was Black American Sign Language. Can you describe that just a little bit?
Well, Black American Sign Language is an expanded version of ASL, American Sign Language. So it has many of the black nuances, it has slang in it, it has many, many gestures, so that often persons who are using ASL, who are white, would have difficulty in understanding the black sign language. But many of them are the same signs. It's just as hearing people do in different areas. You might hear a hearing black person talk, and you hear them using various vernacular in the streets, various signs, and you say, my, that's a slang they use that's accustomed to black people. And that's exactly what it is in sign language.
I want to hear a little bit more about your childhood in terms of what it was like to be at home with your parents versus going into school and having teachers, you know, hearing people speak. And I also know that you have a portion of the book that you want to read that can kind of incorporate just a little bit of that. This is The Summer with Your Grandmother.
Yes.
I want to have you read just a page of that for me.
You want me to read it at this very
moment?
Yeah,
let's do that.
Oh, right. Let's do that. Okay, let me put on my glasses here. And let me just say that this is a story when I was in the South, and my grandmother spoke a strong Southern accent, and it was not unusual for children to stay with their grandparents. Many parents who migrated to the North would send their children down home, as it were, to the South with their parents, grandparents often. And so my grandmother, living in a very naked, if you will, house shack in rural North Carolina. And I arrive there, and she leads me to the bedroom, and here we go. The lit kerosene lamp sits on the floor. The tiny flame flickers, creating shadowy images on the wall. As I watch them, they seem to come alive. The moving shadows are almost human-like, forming vertical zigzag shapes that bounce up and down from the middle of the wall to the ceiling. It is nighttime again, and I am petrified. I lie on the rusty wrought iron bed alone, my arms clasping my body, watching the shadows move, watching the doorway, wondering if the shadows will become human forms and start talking to me. Finally, my heavy eyelids begin to ease together, surrendering to sleep, despite my determination to stay awake. And stay awake I must, because old dead Uncle Henry's ghost may come and drag me away to ghost land. Grandma says she came to see me the night before. Why, he came right in here. He came in here to see you, came in to see me first. Then he took the lamp, walked across that door, and walked across the room, then to the door, and came to see you. He took a good look at you, child, while you sleeping. Old Uncle Henry stood right here, she said, pointing to a spot near the foot of the bed. I try with all my might to picture this shadowy apparition in my mind as she talks. How could all this happen while I'm asleep? After all, I never hear a sound, much less catch a glimpse of the ghost. What does he look like, I ask. Why, he looks just the same as when he was alive. Then how did you know it was him? I know him anywhere. It just looked like him. He had on his nightgown just like he always wore. I said nothing, mulling over her description of Uncle Henry. What's the matter, gal? You scared? I gave her a vacant stare, not uttering a word, simply because I am too ashamed to acknowledge my pure fright and all-consuming fear to the core of my bones, causing me to remain mute.
Tell me about the impact of that experience and the impact of your Southern grandmother on your life as a child.
It was strange, if you will.
Why strange?
Strange because, after all, I was, even though my parents were deaf, I was still in the urban setting in Washington, D.C., rural part of Washington, D.C., and I was just becoming acclimated to hearing people, learning how to adjust in school and so forth. Now I'm going to the South. I have deep Southern roots. The house did not have plumbing. It was no indoor plumbing. And so it was just a whole different life, if you will, from urban Northern Washington to Southern North Carolina.
Tell me about the title of your memoir, On the Beat of Truth. You said it's something, it's a saying that your
yes,
mother used to sign.
Yes,
what does it
yes.
mean?
Well, growing up, we would have candy. My father would bring candy home from Fanny Farmer Dairy Candies. And a deaf man would give them the rejects, the Fanny Farmer candies, if you will, were just the delectable candies. So my father would bring them home, and we would often have candy. Well, they would only give us three a piece, three or four a piece, and that was enough. So every once in a while, we would take one. So my mother came in often, and when she wanted to determine just how truthful we were, she'd say, "Who took the candy? Who took the candy? Who, who?" And she'd look at me first, and then I would say, "Not me, not me." And she'd look at me, and then she'd make this sign, which is the letter B, and you swear it up to God. You just swore, you brought your hand up straight to the heavens. Least, and you said, "Copy me. If not you, not do that sign, bad things happen, devil come." So what happened was I would make that sign on the beat of truth, and if I didn't, I just knew that the floors would open up and I'd go straight down to hell. And as a result, I said, "Okay, all right, I'll name the book on the beat of truth."
Maxine, to close, how do you think people will connect with your story?
In what way?
In terms of your childhood, the experiences that you had and how they've impacted you throughout your life and how they've contributed to your purpose in life.
Yes, I think people will, when they read the book, have an insight into the thinking of deaf people, into the signs, because I write just as people, deaf people talk, so that's in italics. And they will get a glimpse of some of the ups and downs, if you will, of the life of deaf people, lives of deaf people.
Well, Maxine Childress Brown, your book can be purchased at Moodmakers and Village Gate, also Barnes & Noble, Amazon, and from Gallaudet University Press, who published the book. Also, you'll be speaking at Moodmakers on September 13th, if people want to check you out. Oh. So Maxine Childress Brown, former Rochester City Council member and author of the new book, On the Beat of Truth. Thank you so much for being here today.
Oh, thank you.
And that's it for this edition of Need to Know Rochester. I'm Helene B. and Duty Hofer. Thank you for joining us, and thank you for supporting news and public affairs programming on WXXI. We'll see you next Thursday night at 8 o'clock right here on WXXI TV.